is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Dear brothers and sisters everywhere, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته, and welcome to a new edition of your program Ask Huda, where we try our utmost to answer your valuable questions and inquiries. Our phone numbers are area code 002-0238-555-248-249, and the email address is ask@huda.tv. There's also another addition that we will be more than happy to tackle some of your live questions on Facebook account, that is www.facebook.com/msalah. M is capital, S is capital, then A-L-A-H, regular letters. So once again, that is www.facebook.com/M capital, capital M, capital S, then A-L-A-H, M Salah. We try our utmost, inshallah, to take some of these questions during the live program as much as we can, inshallah. Barakallah fikum. A few pending questions, then we'll start taking your valuable questions, inshallah. Umm Abdullah from the KSA, day before yesterday, said, my husband becomes angry with me, then he blames me for his actions. Am I blameworthy and responsible for his sins? Also, my husband divorced me without pronouncing the word divorce, but he later told his family that he divorced me using the word divorce. Is this divorce valid, or does it count? She also has another question, but I'd like to tackle this one first by saying that nothing pleases a shaitan and make him proud more than when a Muslim divorces his wife. Every day, every night, the shaitan sits up his throne on water, on the surface of the water. Then he inspects the misdoings and the evil achievement of his offspring and his horse. So one would come and say, I kept after so and so on until I made him drink wine. He say, well, he didn't do much because soon he will repent and that will wipe away that sin. Another person, I kept after so and so until he committed adultery, until he did this and this and that. Until one of them would say, I kept after so and so until he divorced his wife. So he will draw him near to him, said, you are my chosen one, and he will place the crown on top of his head. Divorce is permissible in Islam, but it should be the last resort. When some people misuse this facility, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it the last resort to sort out problems, that leads to disaster, especially when the kids, when there are kids involved in the marriage life. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam advised one of his companions when he asked him, Ya Rasulullah, عظني, he said, لا تغضب, don't get angry. He said, عظني, he said, don't get angry, لا تغضب, three times. The only advice was, don't get angry, do not get angry. Do not get angry does not simply mean do not get angry, because people, when they get angry, they did not really mean to get angry, but follow the means and take the proper means in order to avoid getting angry beforehand. Wisen up, realize that these are minor things which could lead to major things, and we have to recognize that al-ghadabu min ash-shaytan, anger is from ash-shaytan. As in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had somebody who got very angry with another person, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sitting. So Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, don't you see the redness in his face? This is from ash-shaytan. And ash-shaytan is created from fire, and nothing puts out fire better than water. So if any of you gets angry, let him make wudu, because al wudu would suppress his anger, would control his bad temper, because it would put out the fire that the shaitan kindled in his heart, and he made him angry. When the person is angry, sometimes he does not realize what he is saying. It does not mean that he will not be held accountable for what he says and what he does. In another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I know of a word that if this person who is angry were to say it, it would deliver him out of his anger. The kalima, or the word, the statement that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam referred to is أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. الله سبحانه وتعالى said, وإما ينزغنك من الشيطان نزغ فاستعذ بالله. Whenever you experience any whispers of a shaitan, then seek refuge with Allah. Again is the outcast shaitan. Nothing hurts a shaitan more than seek refuge with Allah سبحانه وتعالى against him and his evil handiwork and plots. So, number one, before getting angry, you have to understand that that would lead to a disaster. Now you say he divorced you. If you say the word divorce straightforward, he pronounced the word divorce and he means you, then that counts as one divorce, whether it was the first or the second or the third. So it does count. What about when one is angry and he says to his wife, you're divorced? It depends what kind of anger. If the person was angry to the point that he could not recognize who is standing before him, he doesn't know whether this is his wife or his sister or his mother, like he's not in his senses, he's not in his normal conditions. This is called ighlaq, locked down. His mind is locked down. He doesn't know what he's saying. And that's why after divorce, when everybody cools down and say, you just divorced your wife, say, did I? I didn't. Did I say so? This is a case of anger which we refer to. But of course, when people divorce their wives, most of the time, whenever they're angry, the dinner is not ready, house is not clean, fight over the kids, whatever. So simple fights and regular anger does not invalidate or waive the divorce if the person pronounces the word divorce. What about if somebody divorces his wife, as in this case, in her absence before somebody else, then she's divorced? What about if he divorced her just between himself and himself? He said, my wife is such and such, and he meant to divorce her. Then that's a divorce, okay? And there is another case where sometimes a person, the husband, uses a metaphor or words which mean divorce, but its straightforward meaning do not necessarily mean divorce, such as the word ilhaqi bi ahlik, go to your family, go back to your house, to your family's house, your father's house. In the long hadith of Ka'b ibn Malik, may Allah be pleased with him in his tawbah, this is the lengthiest hadith, and it is listed by al-Bukhari Muslim in the chapter of repentance. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam declared the mass boycott and Muslims boycott Ka'b ibn Malik, Murar ibn Rabi', Hilal ibn Umayyah, then on the 40th day, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent to them that you should avoid your wives. Should avoid your wives. So Ka'b ibn Malik asked the person who was delivering the message, shall I divorce her? He said, no, just avoid her. So he said, join your family. The word join your family could carry a lot of meanings. So if the person intended by that to divorce his wife, then she's divorced. If he intended to send her home to take a vacation or to visit her family, then this is his intention. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brother Sayyid, United Arab Emirates.
Ya Sheikh, assalamu alaikum, how are you?
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Barakallahu feek, Brother Sayyid.
May Allah Almighty, Allah bless you and the whole team of Huda for Ameen. Your wonderful work. And mashallah.
Ameen.
Yeah, very nice. Sheikh, I'm working as an accountant for a company where the revenue is generated from real estate, retail business, sale of alcohol and golf. And moreover, the company takes loans from the bank, and they have deposited some money in fixed deposits as well. You know, and I was advised not to work in this place. Therefore, I am trying to move out from the company during the past 1.5 years, but I have not received any alternative employment to date. So, Sheikh, I have 3 questions relating to this issue. Am I doing the correct thing by trying to move out from my current job? That's question number one. Number two is, inshallah, myself and my wife are planning to go for Hajj this year. Will Almighty Allah accept our Hajj based on my current earnings? And my question number three is, can you please suggest any supplications to move out from this job and try to get a new job if my the answer is yes to my first question?
Okay. Let me once again ask you, Brother Said, you're very, mashallah, la khata illa billah, eloquent and to the point. The company deals with what exactly? Real estate, you said also liquor and usury, right? Oh, okay, I got that. Thank you, Said. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Maryam from United Arab Emirates.
Yes, assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Please, I have the question. Yes, my first question is, I am raised Islam maybe 3 years now. Now my question is, if someone in my family pass away as a kufr, how do I follow the funeral? It's a future question.
Okay. What's his relationship to you?
Because as a Muslim, I'm a Muslim and my family is purely Christian.
Okay. The person who passed away from your family, what's his relationship to you?
Just example, she's my mother.
Okay.
Or a sister or a brother.
Okay.
Okay. And my second question, please, I need the explanation from Quran. A lady which is legally married to a man and a right hand of a man. I mean, the difference of these two.
No. Can you repeat the question? You said a lady who's married to a man, and the second question
legally
is?
Legally, mean in court. And there is one explanation there. I don't know the surah. It's like a slave, a right hand of a man.
Okay.
That is like it's. Sounds confusing to me, please.
Sure. Okay.
That's all, Sheikh.
No problem. Thank you, Maryam, for calling in. Barakallahu fiki. Abdul Hakim from Nigeria. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam, Sheikh. May God bless you and the Huda team.
Allahumma ameen. Oh Allah, accept. Thank you, Abdul Hakim.
My questions are two. What is the position of Islam on dreams?
On?
The position of Islam on dreams. Dreams when one is sleeping.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's it?
The second question. That is the first question. The position of Islam on dreams. And then the second question I have, I live in northern Nigeria. Can the Sheikh hear me? I live in northern Nigeria. Some people that live with us in northern Nigeria send their children to acquire Islamic knowledge. But they will not give them food. You see, the children will have to be begging before they get food. And you will see them not living in a good condition. They will be dirty and not living well. You can see they are not well taken care of. Does Islam accept that?
Okay.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We have Iman from the KSA. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum, Sister Iman. Okay, please try again. We lost that call. Okay. With regards to Abdul Hakim's second question, Islamic education versus the modern education, empirical science education, and so on, I just presented a lecture in this regard, and the audience were mainly from Nigeria, the student union from all the different states in Nigeria. That was in Al-Azhar University a few days ago. I believe they should post it online. This is very, very important, and it is to the point where there is really a big conflict in Nigeria with regards to the permissibility or the prohibition of studying the sciences and empirical science and receiving, what do you call it, modern education. So this is a very important lecture. I hope you can locate it, and perhaps, inshallah, if we get it, I will post it on my Facebook account. Once again, let me remind our audience that, inshallah, we established a Facebook account to be able to answer your questions or some of them during the live program. The Facebook account is www.facebook.com/msalah. The first two letters of msalah are capital, M and S. With regards to Sayyid's questions, he has three questions. The company that he works in deals with the haram and halal business, but he is an accountant. The portion which is haram is haram, and it is haram to assist in it. It is haram to deal with it. It is haram to audit the accounts or do any business with the liquor, with selling what Allah prohibited, or with the interest and haram investment. So this portion is haram. He said also it deals with real estate. That means the work is mixed, haram and halal. So he asked me the advice, is it the right decision to move to another company or another work? Absolutely. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ شَيَبْتَلَى الطَّلَاقِ. Whoever keeps his duty to Allah, whoever fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will deliver him out of his hardship, will give him a way out of his problems, and وَيَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. We definitely need to put our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the Rabb. The word Rabb means a lot of things. It means He is a creator and He is a provider. He does not forget any of His creatures. He created them and He constantly provides for them. That is a summit, right? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Zariyat, وَفِي السَّمَاءِ رِزْقُكُمْ وَمَا تُوَعَدُونَ. Your provision is controlled in heaven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَن تَمُوتَ نَفْسٌ حَتَّى تَسْتَوْفِيَ رِزْقَهَا وَأَجَلَهَا فَأَجْمِلُوا فِي الطَّلَبِ. There is plenty of hadith and ayat in this regard. So I advise you, yes, to leave the job and look for a halal one. Performing hajj, since your income is mixed from haram and halal, yes, you can still perform hajj. And I hope and I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept your hajj. As far as will it be accepted, no one on earth can tell you so. Even if my money is 100% halal, I cannot tell whether my hajj will be accepted or not. We can only hope and pray that our ibadah will be accepted. Abdullah ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, said in an amazing statement, if Allah have accepted from me one sajda, then there was nothing would be better to me than death. Because if Allah accepted from me any ibadah, even if it was as little as one sajda, then I'm one of al-muttaqeen, then I will go to Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Ma'idah, إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. And make a lot of dua. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Atif from United Arab Emirates.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, brother Atif.
How are you, Sheikh?
Alhamdulillah, shukrullah. Thank you for asking.
Sheikh, I'm from basically India. I have one question. Sheikh, in India, generally anybody is going to suffer or anything, they are go down to somebody or her mother or father, they are taking the blessings. So respect our blessings, I don't know, that type of attitude.
Down?
in Ramadan and Eid al-Adha. Hello.
I hear you, brother.
Yeah, like prostrate, you know, bow down.
Yeah. Basically, it's known that from discussing this with a lot of Indian brothers, these are some cultural traditions, Indian yeah. cultural traditions.
Yeah, no, somebody said in Sharia, this is maybe permissible or not.
No, many it is not permissible. It is not permissible, our deen.
Human being.
No. It is not permissible to bow down to any human being, not even in sports, as a mean of greeting. I know that it's not a ibadah. But you don't seek the blessings from no human being whatsoever, you only seek it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forbade Muslims from bowing down. That includes just lowering the head or complete bowing down or prostration. And he said, if I was going to command anyone to bow down to another, then I would have commanded the wife to bow down to the husband. But bowing down is abrogated. And in our Sharia is not permitted to bow down to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sister Nana from Nigeria, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sheikh, please, I have two questions and one request, please.
Please.
My first question is it allowed for one to observe Nawafal after observing Shafi' and Witr at night? Because there are times at night that one might wake up without intention of maybe performing Nawafil at night and discover you wake up before the time of waking up in the morning instead of looking at the ceiling. And if one decided to maybe observe some Nawafil to get some hasanat from Allah.
It is permissible, like Sister Nana, to do so. If the person...
Is it permissible to observe Nawafil? It is permissible.
If the person prayed witr already, then he went to sleep.
Yes.
And he got up and he decided to pray any Nawafil, voluntary prayer. It is permissible. The recommended thing is that to keep the witr or the witr, both are right, the pronunciations, as the last prayer, to seal up the night prayer with it. But if the person had prayed witr already, it won't stop him from praying again. We discussed this repeatedly, especially during Ramadan. And there are two ways to do it. Simply, the person will be, if he knows that, he will get up, then it is best to postpone the witr to be the last prayer. But if he prayed witr and he went to sleep, then he was alert, he got up, and he wants to pray, perfectly fine. But he is not required nor allowed to offer another witr, because the Prophet ﷺ said, "La witrani fi layla." You should not offer two witr in the same night. Barakallahu fikum, Nana. The dua, Brother Sayyid, to get out of this, there are plenty of ad'iyah. In the Quran, plural of dua. I personally would keep saying, رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. I would keep saying, رَبِّ شَرَحْ لِي صَدْرِي وَيَسِّرْ لِي أَمْرِي. I would keep making istighfar and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness and send the peace and the blessings upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is the most advice in this regard. Assalamu alaikum. Irshad from Egypt.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, brother Irshad.
Hello, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Yeah, my question is it allowed to clip the nails after Maghrib Salah? Is it permissible to clip the nails?
It is.
After,
it is allowed to clip the nails before or after Maghrib Salah. There is no prohibition in this regard.
So during night or day, any time we can.
Barakallahu fikum. It is recommended though to bury or dispose the hairs and the nails in a disposable place so that it won't fall in the hand of a person who may misuse them. How? We all know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam suffered from a magical spell which was cast upon him by a Jew who utilized a boy who used to serve the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who collected some hairs from the comb of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So you should not leave behind hair or nail. Barakallahu fikum. Brother Awal from Nigeria, assalamu alaikum.
Aminu alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. Hey, Shaykh.
Assalamu alaikum.
Aminu alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. Can you hear me?
I can hear you. Go ahead, Brother Awal.
Okay. My question is, which period is the most sunnatic for one to circumcise his child? Is it immediately after giving birth, or is it after 7 years, or is it after 2? I would like to know.
Okay.
And my second question is it bid'ah for someone to wish his Muslim brother Jumu'at Mubarak, Jumu'at Kareem?
Hmm.
Okay, that's my question.
Okay.
I understand it, Sheikh.
Okay. Barakallah fiqh awa. Brother Adnan from the KSA.
Hi, Sheikh. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
How are you, brother?
Alhamdulillah, I'm just fine. Thank you for asking, Adnan.
Alhamdulillah, Sheikh. I have a small question for you. It's regarding my sister. Alhamdulillah, I opened the TV. I was thinking to ask you, and your show immediately came up. Sheikh, it's about my sister. Well, she is married to my first cousin. Okay.
Mm.
What happened, Sheikh? You know, because of the different schools of thought and how the religion is sometimes interpreted in third part of the countries of the world. Basically, what happened? My cousin first time divorced my sister by pronouncement 3 times that I divorce you, divorce you, divorce you. And we are all abroad working. So what happened? We went to settle this matter. And she said, in the light of Sunnah and Islam, if there can be any way for us to reconcile, my dear brother, please help me.
3 times and in the same sitting, right?
In the same sitting.
Okay.
He did that. So basically, I had to rush from, I was in London or I can't remember, Bahrain. I came and we forcefully went to one ulema, and he said, no, there are 2 times Maratania according to Surah Baqarah. And he said, there is a possibility she can go back. Although the husband was not willing to take her back, but we forced our sister to go and said, let's be a happy family because Allah has given you some source of life.
Adnan, you just said that he was not interested in taking her back, right?
Yeah, he was not, but she was begging us. He said, no, he thought that by saying 3 times, it is nullified. From his side, he said, I, with my pure intention, with my pure consciousness, have given her divorce, and he pronounced it 3 times.
Akhi, okay? My question is, if he's not interested in taking her back, what is the purpose of the question?
No, Sheikh, what happened, I'm telling you the history, actually. I'll be very grateful if you can be patient with me. Just what happened, so they went back, basically reconciled, and again he, on another sitting, after 2, 3, 4 months, divorced her again in 3 times with the same pronouncement, that I divorce you, I don't like you, you go back to your family. Then what happened, Sheikh, because this time he did second time, so again I was abroad, my brother called up and said, no, let's to endorse this, let's make a divorce deed. So we went to his house, and the guy signed his divorce deed, and he said, and then my sister basically came home. Now it's been almost 1.5 years. Now he came one day to our house and he lifted the Quran in his hand and said, look, my first time I didn't want to take your sister, but the second time when I divorced her, I was under a spell. Somebody has done some kind of magic to me, and I sincerely...
got the question, Brother Adnan. Barakallahu feek. Jazakallahu khairan. I hope inshallah to deliver the answer in the next segment. Brothers and sisters, we got to take a short break, so stay tuned.
Subhanahu wa ta'ala choose whom he wills, subhanahu wa ta'ala, for his mercy, for his messengership, for the revelation to be revealed, This is not for the human beings to make that decision. If a person would turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sincerely, truthfully, asking for forgiveness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised to forgive. We have as Muslims a duty, and that is to recite the book of Allah, to ponder over the verses, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to act according to the Quran. The mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encompasses everything, but it who would this mercy will be for? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent to all mankind. So the ummah, or the people of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, are all mankind since the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam till the day of judgment. Why waste our life without getting to know every verse in the Quran, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us?
The Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, narrated that when Allah, glory be to him, wishes good for someone, he bestows upon him understanding of the religion, and that Allah makes the path to paradise easy for those who seek knowledge. Preoccupied by work or family in the modern world, a Muslim may struggle to find time for acquiring Islamic knowledge. To ease this struggle, we are launching Hoda Academy to be your gateway to online Islamic e-learning.
Enroll now and study from our renowned scholars. Learn Aqeedah from Dr. Muhammad Salah.
Learn Fiqh from Dr. Hatim Al-Hajj.
Learn Hadith from Dr. Muhammad Saeed.
Learn Tafsir from Sheikh Ibrahim Zidane.
And learn Arabic from our professional instructors.
Successful graduates of Hoda Academy will go through a final test and eventually receive a certificate of completion.
To enroll and learn more about Hoda Academy, please visit us online at hudaonlineacademy.com.
Hoda Academy, your gateway to authentic Islamic knowledge.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. Before we begin answering some of these mini questions, I would like to remind you with the Facebook account. We added the word official by the end, so it should appear on the screen. That is www.facebook.com/msalahofficial. It's all one word. Barakallahu fikum. And the address should appear on the screen as well. We have Maryam from United Arab Emirates, who's a revert. She's been a Muslim for the past 3 years. May Allah strengthen your iman and keep you steadfast on the straight path. She asked about marriage versus milkul yameen. Marriage is when a free woman marries a free man with their free will, with the ijab and qabul, agreement of both, and with the consent of the guardian of the girl, and the husband must pay the dowry, and that must be witnessed by at least two just Muslim men. And it should be publicized so that people know that they are married. Then it undergoes all the ahkam of marriage in the Quran and the Sunnah, and I can just simply summarize all these ahkam in one part of an ayah, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَهُنَّ مِثْلُ الَّذِي عَلَيْهِنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. For them, for the wives, there are rights which are exactly similar to the duties which they owe to their husbands. So there are mutual rights and obligations as well. As far as مَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ, that was pertaining when slavery was permitted, when there was slavery, when the man owned slaves, men and women. So was he allowed to embrace his slave woman? Yes, he was allowed to embrace his slave woman. And that is something that the Islamic Sharia did not invent. Rather, it came to eradicate and eliminate. We all know that even amongst all the prophets of the children of Israel, Prophet Sulaiman alayhi salam had slave women in addition to 100 wives or even more, and so on. So Islam came in order to free the slaves. And we spoke about that almost in a whole episode, or most of it, how Islam freed the slaves via the kafarat, the ransoms, and so on. And if a man embraced his slave girl and she gets pregnant, she becomes umman lil walad. If she delivers a child, then she's free automatically, and so on. And since slavery does not exist anymore, so we're not having any milk al-yameen now. What some people deceive some women with and say that, sell yourself to me and you become milk al-yameen, and he may have more than one wife. He cannot have milk al-yameen nowadays. He cannot have such thing, that is invalid according to the Sharia as well. Why? Because there is only one source for milk al-yameen, which is not available now. So you cannot go to the market and buy human beans. Slavery does not exist. It does exist in some countries, we cannot deny it, but it's illegal though. Barakallahu feekum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Fatima from United Arab Emirates. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam, Shaykh. I've got a question regarding sujda while reading Quran. Sujda which comes while reading Quran. Is it obligatory to perform the sujda?
To perform what?
The sujood, the sujda while we are reading Quran.
Okay. It is an emphatic sunnah to make sujood upon hearing the ayah. If you're the reciter yourself, then yes, you do it. It's an emphatic sunnah. But if you are an audience, if the imam in the salah or outside the salah who recites made sujood, then you're obliged to make sujood. If he did not, then you are not required to do sujood as well. You follow the reciter. Barakallahu feeki.
Sheikh, I've got one more question. Hello?
Yeah, I hear you, Fatima. Go ahead.
Yes. I want to know if the sujood, it comes in the last ayah of the surah we are reciting in the prayer. Example, Surah Alaq, right? There's a sujood in the last ayah of the surah. Mm. How do we do the sujood?
You do a sujood, then you have one of two choices. You get off from the sujood to the standing position, and you can recite the next chapter or a few other verses, then make ruku'ah. Or you're also permitted, and that is the second choice, is after rising up, you stand up, then you just make takbir and you go for ruku'ah without reciting any. That too is permissible. Barakallah fiqh. Faiza from Nigeria. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Yeah, my question is about my friend. Her father wants her to marry his friend. I mean, her father recommended her to his friend. Mm-hmm. And the friend of the father is about 50 years old and she's about 20 years old. And she thinks she doesn't love this man, maybe because he's too old for her. But I don't know the reason why the father is recommending the man. Even though the man does not have any bad qualities, but he has three wives and plenty of children, so the girl says she does not love the man. So how can she go about this situation?
Simply say,
and she has a lot of pressure on her.
Simply say no. And in Islam, it is not permissible to impose marriage on any woman or any girl, whether she's your daughter, sister, working for you, or you have an authority over her. No one is allowed to force any woman, young or old, to marry any person whom she does not agree to. Al-ijabu wal-qabul are both required in marriage, proposal and an acceptance. So if she's not happy with that, she can simply say no. And an advice to the guardians, do not force your daughters in marriage to any person whom you know that they're not happy with it. Barakallah feeke. Riyad from Oman. Assalamu alaikum, Riyad.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sheikh, how are you?
Alhamdulillah. I won't be able to take your question before you mute your TV, please, Riyad.
Okay, inshallah. Ya Sheikh, I want to know, over here in Oman, I've seen that when I'm performing my prayers, for example, I miss my prayer during the Jamaat. I'm in the Jamaat, and I'm performing the missed one or two rakats. Some gentleman coming and just tapping my back, and he, as an imam, he makes me an imam, and he continues to perform a Jamaat with me.
No.
And after some time, I see a whole saf is formed. So is that sort of prayer valid
for you? Okay. Okay means I will answer you, inshallah. Okay. In the same order, I receive your question because I'm afraid that we'll run out of time before answering these pending questions. Abdul Hakim from Nigeria. Ru'ya in Islam. Ru'ya, plural of Ru'ya, which is the night vision. If it is something that is good, then it is recommended to narrate it to your beloved ones. And the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith, الرؤيا الصادقة جزء من 46 جزءا من النبوة. The night vision which comes true, like you see something in a dream and it comes true. See that you got married and you get married to the girl whom you've seen in a dream. You got hired in this company, graduated from this school, whether for yourself or others. This is a good indication. Because the Prophet ﷺ, and for 6 months before Jibreel ﷺ came to him in the cave, used to see the night vision, and it would come as the daybreak, exactly as he had seen it. So that was for 6 months. And the prophethood was for 23 years. So 6 months out of 23 years is like one per 46 parts. So that's why the Prophet ﷺ said that. So it's a good thing. It is also recommended not to interpret the dream yourself, rather ask somebody who is professional in this regard, because your interpretation has an effect on what will happen as a result of this dream. But of course, I would like to clarify one thing. We are a very conscious ummah. Some people get obsessed with dreams, night visions, and they just live in the sleep time. They interpret everything according to dreams. No, this is not the case. If you see a night vision, the Sahaba used to see, whenever they see a night vision, they would go to the Prophet ﷺ to interpret it for them. But they would not just live in to see night visions. It would direct their lives. That was not the case. As far as the Islamic schools, Islamic education, where people just put their kids in without providing them with the proper means, and then when they do not study and get the proper education, they do not graduate, they don't get good jobs, and so on. It is an Islamic command to learn every science that is useful, then it's an Islamic science. Whether jurisprudence, principles of fiqh, or tafsir, or hadith, these ulum have the priority because it will help us to know better about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And any other science, biochemistry, pharmacology, toxicology, analytical chemistry, engineering, mathematics, algebra, astronomy, anything which will make the ummah progress and make it independent, if you study that with an intention, that is called an Islamic knowledge as well. The idea of certain people who ban the empirical education, studying the empirical sciences, is baseless, as in counterbalanced by the Quranic and Sunnah education of the Prophet ﷺ. Why the Prophet ﷺ asked Zayd ibn Haritha, Zayd ibn Thabit, to study a language of another people? Why do we study different language? My native language is not English, nor French. Why do we have to learn these languages in order to communicate with people, in order to give them da'wah? Al-Harith ibn Kilda was a physician at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. As I say, this is a lengthy matter, and hopefully, inshallah, when we get a copy of the lecture, we'll post it on the Facebook account. MashaAllah. Circumcision, awwal from Nigeria. Circumcision, he said, at what time? There is no specific time, But it can be while the child is still breastfeeding or after, but the physician or the surgeon will determine, because sometimes, especially in Europe and in the States, they have to wait. By law, they have to give the child like a general anesthesia. So there is a certain age. They cannot give a child who is young in the first year general anesthesia. But in other countries where the child doesn't have to undergo any general anesthesia or even anesthesia at all, it is better to do it. The earlier is the best, because the child would not feel that much pain as versus if he were to grow up. But if the person grew up and his parents neglected the khitan, then Ibrahim alayhi salam, Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, got circumcised and he was 80 years old. So the earlier is the better. Congratulating one another by saying Jum'ah Mubarakah, happy Jum'ah, blessed Jum'ah, is perfectly fine. Also saying good morning and happy day or happy holiday or whatever, all of that is fine. But the official greeting is Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. So when I say to somebody, happy Jum'ah, happy vacation, it's okay. This is not a religious matter which is prescribed or not prescribed. This is not a religious holy day. But saying you wish somebody a blessed time or a blessed event or a blessed whatever, that's perfectly okay. As long as it is not a tradition where you think that this is something that we have to, like, I'll give an example of the opposite, which is not permissible. It's very common amongst the Arab. After they finish the prayer, they turn right and they turn left. They shake hands with the persons next to them, right and left, and they say, Allah kabul kariya, taqabbal Allah, or may Allah accept. They have to say so. They think this is an inseparable part from the requirements of the prayer. This is an innovation. But we just prayed and we're stepping out of the masjid, and I wished my friend, my brother, an accepted prayer. Say, may Allah accept your prayer. Valid. But when it is considered as a tradition, or as an act of worship, or as a sunnah, now we say, stop it right there. You can't do that, because the Prophet ﷺ did not do it. Divorce three times in the same sitting, according to Al-Jumhur, counts as three. Ibn Taymiyyah, may Allah have mercy on him, and Ibn Al-Qayyim shows the view that it counts as one, as long as it was pronounced three in one in the same sitting. Like I said, you're divorced three times. So this matter is disputed between the scholars, and you said he already did that twice. The person who's used to pronouncing divorce, no matter how many fatwas you give him, he will continue to divorce his wife until he runs out of chances, unfortunately. Then people regret and resort to what's prohibited in order to reconcile, control this. The Prophet ﷺ said to Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu anhu arda in a fantastic hadith, after he advised him with the salah, with the zakah, with patience, with, he said, shall I not guide you to the controller of all of that, of the entire deen? He said, certainly, Ya Rasulullah. He said, kuffa alayka hada. He grabbed hold of his own tongue and said, control this. If we control this, then we are in the safe side. Perhaps next episode, inshallah, I'd like to begin by controlling the tongue and its virtues. And until then, brothers and sisters, I leave you in the care of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. وصلى الله على سيدنا وحبيبنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test. Nah. Keep in my heart your remembrance and in your deen.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى، لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Dear brothers and sisters everywhere, especially when the kids, when there are kids involved in the marriage life. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم advised one of his companions when he asked him, Ya Rasulullah, عظني. He said, لا تغضب. Don't get angry. He said, عظني. He said, don't get angry. لا تغضب. Three times. The only advice was, don't get angry. Do not get angry. Do not get angry does not simply mean do not get angry, because people, when they get angry, they did not really mean to get angry. But follow the means and take the proper means in order to avoid getting angry beforehand. Wisen up. Realize that these are minor things which could lead to major things. And we have to recognize that al-ghadabu min ash-shaytan. Anger is from ash-shaytan. As in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had somebody who got very angry thrown on water, on the surface of the water. Then he inspects the misdoings and the evil achievement of his offspring and his horse. So one would come and say, I kept after so and so until I made him drink wine. He said, well, he didn't do much, because soon he will repent and that will wipe away that sin. Another person, I kept after so and so until he committed adultery, until he did this and this and that. Until one of them would say, I kept after so and so until he divorced his wife. So he will draw him near to him, said, you are my chosen one, and he will place the crown on top of his head. Divorce is permissible in Islam, but it should be the last resort. When some people misuse this facility, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it the last resort to sort out problems, that leads to disasters. So inshallah, to take some of these questions during the live program as much as we can, inshallah. Barakallah fikum. A few pending questions, then we'll start taking your valuable questions, inshallah. Umm Abdullah from the KSA, day before yesterday, said, my husband becomes angry with me, then he blames me for his actions. Am I blameworthy and responsible for his sins? Also, my husband divorced me without pronouncing the word divorce, but he later told his family that he divorced me using the word divorce. Is this divorce valid, or does it count? She also has another question, but I'd like to tackle this one first by saying that nothing pleases a shaitan and make him proud more than when a Muslim divorces his wife. Every day, every night, the shaitan sits up his... Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome to a new edition of your program, Ask Huda. We will try our utmost to answer your valuable questions and inquiries. Our phone numbers are area code 002-0238-555-248-249, and the email address is ask@huda.tv. There's also another addition that we will be more than happy to tackle some of your live questions on Facebook account. That is www.facebook.com/msalah. M is capital, S is capital, then A-L-A-H, regular letters. So once again, that is www.facebook.com/M capital, capital M, capital S, then A-L-A-H, M Salah. We try our utmost.